Salut tout le monde et bienvenue au cinquième cours de révision pour le roman Un sac de bile. Aujourd'hui, on va parler du contexte historique, mais aussi les autres choses importantes et clés qu'il faut mentionner quand on fait un essai pour le A-level. Donc, ça, c'est pour aujourd'hui. Pour la prochaine fois, alors, so guys, for our next time, this is what you need to do before next lesson. Remember, all these lessons are just talking about pointers and revision and trying to get the reading you do at home. I'm trying to like test you on it and to develop it and to get you think about how to use it for the essay. But the most important thing is the work you do at home, the work you do on your revision booklet, which took a long time to create, by the way. The work you do on that is what's essential to you getting a good A level. Now, we're at the very end of this revision booklet. And the last thing I want to do is just talk about writing style and techniques. I keep mentioning it throughout how you can use and mention and talk about it for every single essay. It's quite gritty and hard. So what we're going to do is the final lesson, the final revision lesson out of your six, we'll be looking at writing style and technique and looking how to use that. So you know how this works by now. Go through the reading, but properly read it. Do the activities they ask you to do, highlight, analyze, make your own notes on it, then complete the essay plans, and that's what you need to do for next time. Also, after today's lesson, you'll be so key on this question about le contexte historique. We're going to do a lot of work on it today, so I need an essay. Show me how well you've learned, show me what you've done, ping me an essay, we'll mark it, we'll get you your feedback, and that is how to get good. That's the best way to do it. Is for you to do a practice paper and me to tell you need to do this, you need to do that, you need to do this, and then you correct that, and then you improve for next time. That's what it's all about. That is what's going to really push your learning forward, and it all comes from what you do at home. So make sure you get on that for me. Pour la prochaine fois, s'il vous plaît, mes petits. Mais pour aujourd'hui, on va parler de contexte historique. Et voilà, donc vous savez ce qu'il faut faire. Si vous travaillez dans vos cahiers, s'il vous plaît, mettez-moi sur pause et copiez le titre du genre Contexte historique, c'est ce qu'on va parler d'aujourd'hui. Et vous avez un contrôle de post-it ici, mettez-moi sur pause et on va commencer. Allô mes petits, right guys, if you've restarted me, you've done your contrôle de post-it and you're ready to start. Just before we move on to the answers for that and start looking at this, let me just give you a bit of greater context for this lesson. We're looking at a really specific exam question that came up one year and that people really struggle to answer. And I just want to make sure that when it comes to you and your exams, you think about this and you make sure you don't fall into the pitfalls that they did, and you can really get a top mark on this. So that's what we're going to do today. We're considering the social, cultural, and the political context of Sac de Ville, which will be important if you get a similar exam question, but also it's such an important part of your essay, no matter what the essay question, to get a top mark. You want to show that the part of this book, and a big part of it, is that you understand the social, cultural, and political context that it's written in. You can use that and make a point for that for any essay question they ask. And it's also one of the reasons we're studying this book, and one of the reasons Joseph Geoffroy wrote it, is to take the context here and to talk about the modern day. Remember the epilogue where he says that will never happen again, will it? Or will it? That's what it's all about. This book is a warning from history, and it makes you think about your society and to make comparisons to it and his treatment and how he survived through the kindness of others and the idea of fraternité. How does that exist today with people who arrive in our country, either running from wars, from asylum or immigration to come here for a better life? How are they treated? How does society view them? What do people say about them? What do they print about them that they would never be able to say about Jews or something? Alors, pensez de tout ça, c'est ce qu'on va parler de aujourd'hui. We're also talking about broadening your essay. If you're asked about something specific about his, like the historical context, that's great. But what about fraternité? What about bien contre le mal? What about Bill Dons Romain? Can't you still talk about these things? Aren't they still important? Of course they are. On va discuter comment utiliser tout ça dans vos dissertations. Donc ça, c'est pour aujourd'hui, c'est ce qu'on va faire. Et pour le contrôle de post-it, j'ai dit plusieurs fois, if you've got some vocabulary that you know, you can put this into your exam to ensure your exam's high level. So you've got to learn it. You've got to know it. Il faut savoir toutes les phrases clés à l'envers. Et c'est ce qu'on a ici. Donc, that refers to, cela fait référence à. You can use this with a quote. When you talk about a part of the novel, utilisez le vocabulaire ici de. We find out that on se rendre compte que. To find out, you say we take it into account. We find out that this or that, c'est une phrase idéale. That makes us see that. Cela nous fait voir que. This is a really nice advanced piece of grammar, advanced phrase that you can drop in so many times or adapt it. Utilisez-le. And finally, this idea is linked to cette idée. Est lié à. Look is feminine here. Loads of your essay feedback is about when to use ce, cette, celui before a vowel. I use so much of this in your EBIs. And here, when you learn a phrase, learn that it's feminine. So this is our form of cette. Ce, cette, says this has got to be feminine. So this has got to be feminine. That might seem like a small thing, but small things matter to the examiner. If they want to give you a top mark, but you're making basic masculine and feminine errors, that's really going to cost you. So when you're learning a phrase, learn the gender, make sure you absolutely nail it. That's the strength of set phrases in your essay. Voilà. So this is one thing we're going to look at. I am going to talk, I'm going to look at some examiner's feedback today and see how advanced you think the A level essay will be. Mais ce qu'on va faire avant tout ça, il faut l'utiliser, mais je veux les idées. When you look at an exam question, people very, very quickly make up their minds as to what they're going to add, and they quickly do their plan. And I've seen people in A level particularly doing this, and I used to do it myself. I look at a question and be like, right, one, two, three, four, bullet point my ideas. Okay, let's get writing. There's not a second to lose. But when I got to uni, I took a more sort of laid back approach, and I was like, right, let's think about this deeply. If I spend 10 minutes thinking about it, I'm going to write a better essay, and it's going to be quicker to write rather than writing and thinking, oh God, I forgot to mention this. So just take your time, and this is what I want you to do today. Voilà. So here's our essay question. This question is actually really nice, but what's it about? You've got two parts. So analysez en quoi le roman est avant-tout en roman sur la Seconde Guerre mondiale. So loads of people go, right, Second World War, I need to talk about the Chantier de Jeunesse. I need to talk about anti-Semitism, treatment of Jews. I need to talk about occupation, and voilà. That is the wrong step. Calm yourself down. Take yourself a step back. First off, let's analyze this question. Let's make sure our exam technique is on point. Do you understand what this question is specifically asking you? What about en quoi? Analysez en quoi le roman est avant-tout en roman sur la Seconde Guerre mondiale. That en quoi means like in what ways, or maybe to what extent. So analyze in what ways this novel is avant-tout, is before anything else, before all, above all, a novel on the Second World War. Now, in doing that en quoi, aren't they asking you to explore other things the novel is about? I think it is. So I need to write in the context of the Second World War and talk about what we learn about the Second World War. But what about our other themes? Bien contre le mal. Does the Second World War help us to talk about that theme? Absolutely. Fraternité, which I'd include in the first, or does it absolutely donc penser de tous les thèmes clés qu'il faut utiliser. So what I want you to do before we really get into this lesson, before we look at the pictures and we look at a model essay, I want you to think. This is your exam question. You put me on pause. What are you going to write your essay about? I've got four key questions to make you think about it. Put me on pause now. Set a timer for 2 minutes to give yourself that sheer exam panic time. Okay, so you've opened your exam paper, you've seen this question, you think, brilliant, I'm going to smash this. We've translated what the question means. Now's your planning time. Just 2 minutes. Yeah. What are you going to write about? Think about these key questions. Put me on pause and go for it. All right, 2 minutes is up if you restarted me. Keep this somewhere. I'm obviously not going to get feedback from you. This is a video. We'll come back to this once we've discussed the pictures and once we've gone through it together. And then you can add to it, or you can think about it, or you can say, that was rubbish. I'm not going to do that. But this is a useful technique to show you and get you thinking about planning your essays. But what we're going to do is we're going to look at the historical context, and we're going to look at this question, and we're going to work through it together. Donc. Et alors, vous savez ce qu'il faut faire ici. J'ai choisi 8 images ici du texte qui parle de la contexte historique ici. Donc, ce qu'il faut faire pour tuer les images, mettez-moi ce poste Et il faut répondre aux trois choses ici. Donc, qu'est-ce que l'image nous montre? Pourquoi est-ce que Mr. Venice a choisi ces images ici? Qu'est-ce qu'il représente? Donc, pensez de ce que je viens de discuter. L'image nous montre quel thème. Évidemment, l'image parle de contexte historique, mais comment lier l'image et le contexte historique aux autres thèmes clés qu'on étudie? Finalement, comment discuter ce thème que tu as identifié pour répondre à la question du genre? Donc, si on parle de fraternité, c'est quoi la signification de fraternité? Et les questions de genre, qui est le romain et aventure en romain sur la Seconde Guerre mondiale. Si on parle de méfiance des autres, si on parle de Monsieur Monseigneur, comment utiliser lui pour parler du thème du genre, de questions du genre. Donc, pensez de tout ça, put me on pause now, think about what you've got. There's a really nice extra challenge today. Comment on the narrator's voice and its impact on these themes. Hard for all the themes, but definitely possible and going into next lesson. Put me on pause now. I really want you to think deeply about this. Now, there's eight images. If you do six, fine. But if you do all eight, even better. Think about how to use these themes, what to do. You don't have to write an essay for each of these. Just do like a few bullet points for each of them. How would you use this in your essay? When you restart me, I'll go through how I would use it. Et voilà mes petits. Alors donc, j'ai choisi les images que je mettrai ensemble. Alors, so, I put these first two images with the next two. So, these four images I put together. It might be in a separate paragraph, but I think they all do some things. So, let's talk about historical context. Can we use these images? And then, what theme does it show us? Donc, les premières deux images sont importantes. Le premier, ici, c'est quand Joe et Maurice arrivent à Hôtel Excelsior. Ils ont été capturés et c'est le headquarters du Gestapo. Ici, ils vont demander les questions à Joe et Maurice pour vérifier s'ils sont les juifs ou non. Il y a plein de personnes juives ici. J'ai lié cette image avec l'image dans le deuxième chapitre quand la mère Joffo cul de l'étoile jaune sur le manteau de Joe. Alors donc, qu'est-ce que les images nous montrent? Ceci, c'est dans le contexte historique, cela nous donne l'idée d'antisémitisme. Donc, pensez du question et je dirais que on apprend beaucoup du contexte historique de l'antisémitisme à cette époque. On voit la persécution de juifs tout au long du roman et on apprend la vie des juifs avec toutes les choses petites comme il fallait porter une étoile jaune à Paris et voilà et aussi les choses plus pires on a une expérience de la peur de la communauté juive parce que ils ont été capturés. On a un sentiment des rafles quand les Juifs ont été capturés et finalement ils sont envoyés vers les camps de concentration. Donc tout ça, on gagne une idée des sentiments des Juifs pendant les guerres. Aussi, c'est plus frappant parce qu'on voit tout au travers les yeux de Joe, un petit enfant. In seeing it all through Joe, we have this idea of how terrible it is because Joe is our narrator, a little 10-year-old boy, and let's face it, we love Joe. What a little sweetheart. And in his innocent way, where he doesn't understand even what being a Jew means, how can he be held responsible and attacked and hated and have these horrible things happen to him? He's an innocent boy who's done nothing. He's just had the misfortune of being born a Jew at this time. Nothing that he could have done about it. So this shows us the anti-Semitism, but also shows us, in a bigger sense, the futility of racism and these ideas that come. So that is my first point in the essay. we learn about anti-Semitism. We learn that they have to wear a yellow star, which makes them stand out and attacked and beaten up at school. We learn the ideas that actually society was racist at this point towards Jews. And we learn even worse. We have a feeling of the terror and horror and just the disgusting treatment of the Jewish people at this time, where they were rounded up like animals and they were sent to the slaughterhouse like animals, like his father was. He doesn't mention his father being slaughtered. We know he went to a concentration camp and died. In the reading for your homework, you will have read that his dad actually went to Auschwitz and died, and we know the signification of that. Everyone talks about Auschwitz is the one camp that everyone can name. So we learn about this. It's all about the war, and we learn this. Yes, but think about what I said about that question. And to get the top marks, you've got to come away from the question and think about en quoi. So yes, we learn about this and it's fascinating. We learn a lot about the historical context, but this book is more than just telling us about the treatment of Jews and how terrible it is. It's telling us about the war. And Joe prévient le lecteur dans l'épilogue. Joe's warning the reader. This is a warning from history. And in the treatment of the Jews, this book is telling us, don't let this happen again. This will never happen again. This is what the warning's about. Does it happen again? I mean, absolutely. Think about the refugee crisis. Think about kids and their parents having to cross the Mediterranean and Katie Hopkins in the Daily Mail saying, get gunboats and sink them. Think of that, subhumanizing these people, and what are they guilty about? They've just got the misfortune of being born in a horrible war-torn country like Syria or Libya, where they don't have any chance of a good life and they have to flee it. And how are they treated? Like animals to us. We don't want them here. Get rid of these refugees. They're refugees. You know, they've got nowhere else to go. So this is what it's about. It's a bigger warning from history to look at our own society. And that is the point to make. Alors donc, avec l'antisémitisme, je l'ai mis avec un autre thème qui est plus petit, mais c'est la fuite. Donc fuir, c'est une autre chose qui nous fait voir la vie sous l'occupation. Et c'est le fait qu'avec l'antisémitisme, les enfants ont dû faire les choses terribles. Un enfant de 10 ans et un enfant de 13 ans doivent quitter leur famille à Paris. Ils doivent voyager la longueur et la largeur de la France pour échapper les nazis. Donc cela nous montre la fuite. Et voilà. So this is another thing we learn, that children and families have to do extraordinary things, and that is le contexte historique de la guerre, to get away from the war. The normal social society where you look after your kids and they don't go anywhere without their parents, particularly at 10 years old, is taken away. And they actually have to run, and they have to run away and fend for themselves. Now, this happens throughout life and throughout history as well. My grandma's parents died when she was 13, and as one of the oldest in their house in Ireland, she had to go to England to work and send money back at 13 years old. Can you imagine? Like, but that's what life was like back then. And that's what life is like during the war. So running away, we see these extraordinary things, and we learn that our normal norms of society, of kids being protected and loved, that's all gone. And this is also, link this in, this is bigger than the war, because we learn about this, but we also learn about the strength of family. And that's a real focus in this novel, that Joe and Maurice and their parents is all about getting the family together and the importance of the family. Donc, do you see what I've done here? I've taken two things where we learn about the historical context, and then I've tried to widen them out and say, but it's more than just the historical context. It's relevant to us today because of this and that. So this is looking at antisémitisme et le thème de la fuite. Quoi de les autres thèmes? Alors, on y va. Alors, pour le deuxième paragraphe que j'écrirai, j'utiliserai peut-être toutes les choses qu'on voit pendant la guerre. Donc, j'ai mis trois images ensemble ici que je veux discuter. Le premier, c'est quand Joe et Maurice marchent à l'école et ils parlent d'une affiche qu'ils ont vue. La deuxième, encore une fois, c'est la mer qui cule l'étoile. Et le troisième, c'est Moi sans nouvelles, qui est le chantier de jeunesse, où on cache les juifs et avec mes chaussures bien aiguilles. Alors donc, avec tout ça, je parlerai de la contexte de la guerre. Et je dirai dans mon dissertation que tout au long du roman, on apprend beaucoup de la guerre parce qu'il parle de chantier de jeunesse. Il parle de STO quand le Gestapo arrive et cherche les frères aînés. Il y a les affiches. Il y a l'abus contre les juifs à l'école, on apprend de la pénurie, tout ça. Donc on apprend beaucoup de l'État français sur l'occupation et tous les problèmes. Et donc avec ça, le lecteur peut mieux comprendre la guerre. Mais aussi, c'est plus important, c'est l'ambiance de la guerre. Et c'est ça que je veux parler de maintenant. So yes, like I think an easy trap to talk in, like how's it about the war? Say, well, they talk about the posters, so we learn about the anti-Semitism. We learn about the Star and Jews being attacked. We learn about the Chantier de Jeunesse existed and Joe Morris lived there. We learn about the STO. We learn all this about the war, which is true, but that's really the trap, the piège of this exam question, where they don't just want you to talk about what you learn about in the war. I mean, it's a decent answer, but it's not enough. What else do we learn about? Yes, we learn about all these physical things, but this book gives us an insight into the war through Joe. And what's the bigger thing we learn about? Not just the things that are happening, mais pour moi, la chose la plus importante, c'est que on apprend l'ambiance en France pendant la guerre. What is the atmosphere in France? What is it like in France? I want to talk about Rosette et la dénonciatrice dans le village. Donc, the ambiance in France has changed during the war, and the idea is fear, distrust, not trusting each other. That's the sort of society that went. So don't just talk about what happened in the war, but you get an inkling, you get a view, a vision into what society was like. People didn't trust each other. People lived in fear. People were dying every day. And this is a really big insight into it, which is a deeper, more analytical point than we learn about Chantier de Jeunesse. We learn about STO. We say, no, we actually, from Joe, have a first-hand account of what life is like during the war, and we get to learn what people think about it. Qui est important pour nous. Then, think about how to branch this out larger. This is more than just about the war. When we look at like how Jews are treated, it makes us think about our society today and how much we help each other out and how different it is. Or is it? Remember Joe's warning from history. That's his book. It's a warning from history about this is what can happen. C'est plus que la guerre. L'ambiance peut retourner when you think about people being denounced. Yeah? People being denounced and sent away. What about l'immigration aujourd'hui? What about that? So a few years ago, I was in Cochalton, and it's a place called the Blue Bengal, which is a Balti. And I was there with my girlfriend and her sister, Rosanna, and her brother, Joe. Sat down Friday night, like from the Midlands. I love Indian food, even though it's not as good in London as it is from the Midlands. Anyway, what is Mr. Ennis on about in this revision video? Who shows up? Immigration. They show up at the Indian restaurant and they come in, and there's like 10 of them. They walk into the kitchen and they arrest this bloke and they take him out and they put him in the car. And I just couldn't believe my eyes. So I went out and I talked to one of the immigration staff, and she was like a Far East Asian woman. So I was talking to her and I said, how have you got this job? Like, what's your family? Like, coming from a family of immigrants myself, I just think I can speak about it. And I said, I'd never do your job because, you know, my grandma came here to work. And if she didn't, you know, what could she have done in rural Ireland? Ireland was really poor back then. Like, you know, and your parents or your background, you've obviously had the opportunity to come to this country and you've obviously done well because, I mean, now you're a fascist. You know, with a uniform. And I said, how can you do this job? And she was like, she wasn't having any of it. And she was like, she radioed for backup and they all came. They're like, what's your problem? I was like, what's my problem? You're taking away a man. And they're like, yeah, he's here illegally. And I was like, what do you mean he's here illegally? What? Has he flown in from out of space? He's working in a restaurant. Like, what's your problem? He's got a family. Anyway, it was a disgusting moment and it really stuck with me. And Lauren was absolutely ashamed. She's like, we can never come and eat here again after you've made a scene. But anyway, this is my point, right? So, talking about atmosphere, and you say, oh, it doesn't happen today. It's fine today. Of course, we wouldn't be racist to people. I mean, think about how immigrants are treated and how they're running away and how they're hiding it and their life and what people do about it. Make the link to today's society, because that's what Joseph Joffre wants you to do. That's the warning. And there's this really famous poem, and I can't remember it completely, but it's about someone who goes to the concentration camp, and he says, first they came for the trade unionists, but I wasn't a trade unionist, so I didn't speak out. Then they came for the socialists, but I wasn't a socialist, so I didn't speak out. Then they came for the Jews, but I wasn't a Jew, so I didn't speak out. And it goes on. And then he says, now they're coming for me, and there's no one left to defend me. And that was like a poem from someone who died in a concentration camp. And it's a really powerful message that if you don't stand up, and if you don't, do what's right and defend each other in fraternité, then eventually society is going to go wrong for everybody. And that's what we learn from the context de Dugger. We don't just learn about what's happening, we learn about the atmosphere, and that makes us think about the atmosphere for us today over certain things. Is it the same? Have we changed? Have we learned the lessons? Et voilà, that's what I'd use these things for. So you see, for my essay, I'm still talking about the historical context, but I'm talking about life today and a relevant one. Don't do like in your essay a long paragraph about you in a curry house, but drop some things in to talk on what you think about in an intelligent way. Et voilà, les dernières images j'ai choisies sont ici. J'ai l'image du prêtre qui ment aux soldats allemands pour sauver la peau de Joe et Maurice. Et j'ai la deuxième image, c'est Monsieur Subenaguy, le chef de Moisson Nouvelle, le chantier de jeunesse, et la citation célèbre, Votre père m'a parlé de vue, vous serez bien ici et en sûreté. C'est évident pour nous, les lecteurs, que Monsieur Subenaguy cache les Juifs ici. À Moisson-Nouvel. Et finalement, on a l'inverse. On a Monsieur Monseigneur, le collabo, le pétainiste, le raciste, hein, le fasciste. Et on a trois personnes différentes aujourd'hui. Donc, pensez des questions du genre. Et quand il faut parler de contexte historique, il faut dire qu'il y a les personnages clés que Joe parle de qui représentent les personnes différentes pendant la guerre. Donc, on apprend plus de la guerre avec les personnages que Joe parle d'eux. On a en premier Mission Monseigneur. Il représente le mal, les idées fascistes et tue les personnes en France et partout en Europe qui étaient en faveur de Hitler, qui étaient en faveur de fascisme. Il est l'exemple vivant, n'est pas vivant maintenant, mais pendant le roman, l'exemple vivant du fascisme et de collaboration en France. On apprend les différences entre les personnes. Il est l'exemple des collabos, mais on a aussi l'inverse. On a les exemples des personnes qui étaient les résistants. Ils étaient les résistants parce qu'ils ont refusé à suivre les idées des occupants. Le prêtre a refusé. Il sauve les enfants. Il n'est pas imbécile, hein. Il sait que Joe et Maurice sont les Juifs. Il sait qu'ils échappent Paris et il les protège, même si cela lui coûte cher. La même chose avec Subenaguy. Si il est capturé, si on sait qu'il cache les jeunes Juifs, à Moisson-Nouvel, c'est Auschwitz pour lui. C'est fini pour lui. Mais il fait ça. Donc, ici, pour la dissertation, on apprend plus de la France. And we learn that the French people had a choice. Some of them were collabo and they went along like Monseigneur. They either supported the Nazis or they didn't speak out and they didn't fight against it. So they didn't do anything or they supported the Nazis. That was one type of people and you learn about them through the character of Monseigneur. You also have les résistants who represent the good. Now, these are the people who stood up, who did things, who protected Jews, who fought against the Nazis, etc. And we learn from the novel, we learn about the Second World War that really people were put into these two camps. You're either for this or for that, and they represent the wider view of this story, which is the good versus the bad in humanity. So I'd say, yes, this book does teach us avant tout about the Second World War and about people and how they acted, but in a more general sense, this tells us about people in general. We all have the ability to do the right thing and to be brave and to look after our fellow man and fraternité and to do what's right. But we also have the ability in us to do the wrong thing, to hate, to attack people different to us. And we see this in this extreme situation that is war, which is like the catalyst to these two elements coming together. Which way is it going to go? It's not really a good comparison because they'd come together if they were elements, but still, that's what you've got. You've got the two extremes, and we see that. Now, talk about the real world. We can see this. Everything is a question of good versus evil and what we think about. So that is what you need to talk about. I haven't really talked about our extra challenge. If you've had a go at it, brilliant. I've touched on it about seeing things through Joe's eyes. Think about now, how does his voice impact on these themes? Because he's innocent, he's a 10-year-old boy, and we see it through his eyes, and from that the ideas are more striking. The horror of war is more striking because we know a little boy has to see it. The good in people is more striking because we know that he's so vulnerable, and that's what you need to put in him writing in the first person from him as a little boy. These themes are more striking, and that'd be a beautiful point to make in your dissertation. Hello, right, guys. So, back to this activity that we did before the photos. Now, what I want you to do is look at your essay plan or like look at how you answered these questions. Are you going to add anything more to it now? Are you happy with what you wrote the first time? Are you going to extend anything? When you put me on pause, look through your ideas and think, am I going to use that again? Would I use this in my essay? What about this? See if you can just redraft it and I do a brand new answer to these questions, including everything you want. Do that in a few minutes. When you think you're done, restart and we'll carry on. All right, so you should have a sort of essay plan or at least some ideas that you want to write about answering those questions. Here's mine. Let me talk through what I've done. So it's not the neatest of essay plans, but I had to fit it onto one slide. Here's my very clear four paragraphs about what I want to talk about. Okay, so let's start with hitting the question, analysing in what ways the book is before all else or above all a book on the Second World War. So first point, I'm going to talk about the context of the war and say we learn so much about the war from this book. Certainly, it is avant tout un roman du Second Guerre mondiale. So we have loads of examples. For example, we see images and things for the war. We learn about the Chantier de Jeunesse, and I'm just going to show my knowledge of all the things that happened in the war, and then I'm going to go the extra mile. The reader can better understand the war, but also the ambiance or society during the war. We get an insight into society during the war. Then my quote is Rosette and the Dénonciatrice, and I say this is more than just this. It makes us think about our society and how we treat certain members of society, for example, immigrants who still go under the same idea that they're rounded up, taken away, deported, treated subhuman. They're not allowed to do things that we're allowed to do because they're from a different country or born in a different country or whatever. So it makes us think about our society. So it goes beyond because we understand the context. Same thing with antisemitism. We learn firsthand about the persecution des Juifs, and we see it all from the eyes of Joe, an innocent boy. We see that he's nothing to do with this. He doesn't even know what a Jew is, but he faces this terrible persecution and narrowly escapes being killed and sent to Auschwitz himself at Hotel Excelsior, all because of the fact that he is a Jew. He's born into this religion. And for this shows us how society was, but also it's more than just about the war, because Joe is warning us in the end that this could happen again and to fight against it, and that's almost our duty to fight against this. So this book educates us and tells us how to do. I'd also say the book teaches us a lot about the war through its characters. Every single character is included to show us the two extremes, but it's more than this. This book is about good and evil, and we learn about humanity and how humans react to different things. And then finally, I didn't like this point, so stuck at the end, we learn about running away. We see life in the occupation, and we see this idea that family, love is the most important thing. That's the happy ending. They end up all together at the end. Yes, they lost their dad, but this is what's important. It teaches us what's important in our lives is our family, which you might not be feeling now because I've made this video during lockdown for coronavirus. However, family love is what it's all about. So guys, that is what the novel is. That would be my essay plan. Now, if you've got something different to this, it's absolutely fine. Remember, your ideas and your opinions when I mark your essays are beautiful. So that's fine. It's how you express it. What we're going to do now is look at a model essay. Alors, I've not written this model essay. In previous ones, I've been the one writing them. This is one from the revision guys. Actually set as part of your homework, but we're going to look into it. So keep that in mind. This is a good essay, but it's not near as good as I'd write. But I'm saying it's not a perfect essay. It does have flaws with it, which we'll discuss. But it's a very good essay that could get you a very good mark. So what we're going to do, alors, il y a certaines activités qu'on va faire maintenant. Le premier activité, c'est la même question d'examen. Voilà, donc, vous avez un texte, comme le cordonnier, je vais lire le texte, il faut écouter moi et il faut écrire les mots manquants dans les espaces, compléter le dissertation avec les mots qui manquent en m'écoutant. Ça, c'est activité 1. Après avoir fait ça, I want you, and we'll analyse this together, once you've got your completed essay, look through what the examiner said about it, and tell me, what do you think about what the examiner said? Do you agree? Do you disagree? Have a little look through and see the examiner's commentary on it and see what you think. Après, il y a beaucoup de vocabulaire important ici, donc cherchez dans le texte pour trouver le vocabulaire clé que tu pourrais utiliser dans vos propres dissertations. Et voilà. Et finalement, la dernière chose à faire. Donc, je vais expliquer celui-ci en anglais parce que c'est différent à ce qu'on fait normalement. So, one criticism I'd have with this essay is it does go further and deeper at a certain point, but they could do it after every paragraph. They can add that wider range, looking at society, making comparisons between the society then and now. They could do that in almost every point they make, but they don't. And I think that's what would limit this essay. I still agree with the examiner, it's still a very good essay, but it's limited, and just one or two sentences would push this into a top essay. So what would you add from the wider context? Here it says on pourrait ajouter, one could add what. So for each point, how could you add that or put in something else to broaden it and make it wider and more analytical? That is a sort of extra challenge today. It is a big challenge, but you all have to have a think about it. Your proper extra challenge is after you've done this, when you've said, oh, this links to that, and they've not made that link, I want you to write one of the paragraphs to support your idea. Alors, la première chose à faire, il faut m'écouter, il faut compléter le texte. Alors, la question c'est, analyser en quoi le roman et avons-tu un roman sur la Seconde Guerre mondiale? Nul ne pourrait nier qu'un sac de bile est un roman sur la Seconde Guerre mondiale, étant donné les thèmes importants qui sont abordés, comme le traitement des Juifs et la France sous l'occupation allemande. Dès les premières pages du roman, Joseph Chauffaut plante le décor de la guerre. En effet, en revenant de l'école, Joseph et Maurice voient deux soldats allemands, ce qui montre bien que la France est sous l'occupation allemande. Plus tard, ces deux SS parleront de la guerre dans le salon de coiffeur. Paragraphe 2. De plus, un des aspects les plus marquants de cette guerre est celui du traitement des populations juives par les Allemands, et c'est en effet le thème principal de ce roman. Joseph Chauffaut doit échapper à la persécution nazie. Tout au long du roman, Joseph Chauffaut raconte ses aventures à travers la France. traqués par la Gestapo, comme les contrôles de papier, la délation et l'épisode à l'hôtel Excelsior. Dans son autobiographie, Joseph Joffo expose le sort des populations juives. Paragraphe 3. Il ne faut pas oublier tous les autres détails de ce roman qui illustrent la vie pendant la Seconde Guerre mondiale. Par exemple, on voit les enfants qui franchissent la zone libre grâce à des passeurs. On comprend aussi que la France subit des pénuries et le rationnement à cause du manque de nourriture. À l'école, Joseph et Maurice mangent des biscuits vitaminés. Joseph nous dresse vraiment un tableau réaliste du quotidien de la guerre mondiale. Paragraphe 4. Il faut aussi noter que chaque personnage représente un groupe d'individus de la guerre. Par exemple, la famille Joffo représente le peuple juif, Monsieur Monseigneur, les collaborateurs, le clergé, les justes de la France. Ce symbolisme est très efficace pour pouvoir traiter de tous les aspects de la guerre. Paragraphe 5. Cependant, selon moi, ce roman n'est pas seulement un roman sur la Seconde Guerre mondiale, puisque certains aspects dépassent l'aspect historique. Par exemple, d'autres thèmes comme l'enfance et l'espoir sont très importants dans l'histoire. Il n'est pas anodin que Joseph Joffo se concentre sur son enfance et toutes les personnes qui l'ont aidé plutôt que sur l'atrocité de cette guerre. Pour conclure, je dirais qu'un sac de billes est sans doute un roman qui parle de la Seconde Guerre, mais en considérant d'autres interprétations, ce n'est pas, pour moi, que un roman de la guerre mondiale. Le roman a bien plus de signification. Alors, guys, you can rewind, pause, listen back to that as much as you can. Make sure you really understand this essay before we look at it. Hello, mes petits. Right, guys, so you've listened really well to that. It's not really about the gap fill, it's about listening and reading through in depth that essay. But here's ici, c'est les mots qui manquent. Donc, mettez-moi ce poste et corrigez les choses que vous avez fait. Some really nice language. I think the real strength of this essay is how beautifully it's written, even if the content isn't perfect. All right, so put me on pause. Mark up what you've got. Next slide shows the rest of it. Et voilà, so here's the other words that you got missing. Hopefully you've really understood this essay and you've got a good idea about it. What I want you to do now is put me on pause, go through the other activities. We've talked about them in this video of what to do. Next, I'm going to talk about the examiner's comments. Et voilà, right, hopefully you've had time to read through these and you've got your own idea about this essay and what you think about it. Now, a lot of these things I agree with, a few things I'm going to pick up and go through. So, it's definitely got a nice logical structure, love that. Good introduction and five fairly equal paragraphs in the conclusion. The examiner wants a three-part essay. The conclusion's, the introduction's a bit short for me. Conclusion's very good. The introduction's a bit short. We've talked about ways to lengthen them and having a set one that you can definitely do to impress the examiner. The points they made are all relevant. There's nothing that they could have cut out here. And they're exposed in a logical fashion, completely agree. Each paragraph focuses on one main idea and the candidate has used his knowledge of the book well to support his points, completely agree. Good P here, they've said this is what I'm going to show, and then they're really clear in showing it with just a few nods to the book. Now, I'd like a bit more, I'd like some quotes, I'd like some greater analysis, but they're saying you don't need that, which is probably true, but like, it just makes a stronger essay and a stronger argument. But what they do really well is they like throw in tiny little details, like about the vitamin biscuits and the cod liver oil that they have to take. That is a really nice example that will make them stand out, and it shows a good knowledge of the book. So I like that, which is the next point as well. The final paragraph. Now, this is the one. The final paragraph shows a perceptive understanding. Yeah, it does. The final paragraph is absolute gold dust, and the one before it is good. Could
this candidate have done more throughout to make sure every paragraph showed a perceptive understanding. I really, really, really think they could. The rest I agree with. Yeah, maybe too short the introduction. The language used, oh yeah, the language that this candidate used is excellent. It's a really beautiful essay, very well written for an A-level student, definitely complex. And the examiner says they would likely, they always say that, receive a mark for the top band. So basically, you're looking at an essay that's around a grade A, likely to be an A. I'd agree with that. It's definitely a B to A. If it is an A, it's definitely on the lower end because with that one in green that I've ticked three times, the final paragraph's great, but they could do a lot more of that throughout the essay. Let's have a little look at that now. Avant, before we look at that, let's just go through. There's some lovely language. Now, when I show you any model essay that the examiners say are good, nick as much as you can out of it. One can't deny. You can put that in every essay. Remember, the examiner said this is advanced language. We're going to take the best bits of it throughout the novel, tout au long du roman. You can say that for every essay. Learn that phrase, get it in, get the marks for it. To expose the lot of, right? So lot, I really struggle to translate here. If you're talking about the lot of a people, it means like the problems they had. So here it's exposer le sort de personnes juives, for example. It also should be noted, il faut aussi noter que, lovely Lincoln phrase that you can use, very effective, très efficace, and then it isn't trivial, so it means it's like, it is important. So rather than saying, c'est important, you can say, il n'est pas anodin que, it isn't trivial, it's not something throwaway, it is an important part. That's a lovely line. Never seen that before in an A-level student using it. Bravo, that's why they deserve a top mark. So that was their real strength. But what about the content? Donc, ce que j'ai fait for the content and what I invited you to do was just to think for each paragraph that they've written very well, could you add something more? So for the first one, and let's translate this paragraph as much as we can so we know we're all clear because this is all revision. From the first pages, Joe, I like this, paints a picture, plan le décor de la guerre. Lovely French there. He goes back to school, they see the German soldiers, and then they get their haircut. Okay, good. He's saying, like, right from the start, we're getting an idea of the war, and he gives an example. Fine, but couldn't you add something more? What about Thea? We don't just see German soldiers, which is what this candidate said, who they say gets an A. We also get an idea of the fear. We, as the reader, feel the fear. Joseph doesn't because he's a kid and he thinks it's a laugh, but we also see the innocence in Joe. So yes, it's important, but we get more of a sense of fear, the fear that everyone is living with. So yes, we see like the posters and German soldiers, but what's the impact of that? What would you say if there's two SS walking down the road and you were a Jew, you know, like this, what would you say if there's a big group of racists walking down the road? You'd think, oh my God, am I going to get abused here? Then this is what they're thinking about. I don't. Second one here, point two. More and more, the more striking things of this war is the treatment of the Jewish population. Great point. They have to escape Nazi persecution all throughout it. They go across France, and we see they get what they call this contrôle du papier. They ask for their ID on the train, sort of like questioning in the Hotel Excelsior. And he says here in this autobiography, he shows what it was like for Jewish people. Perfect. What can we add to this? That this is more. The reason that he's showing it is because he warns this can happen again in history, and it is. That's the next step that they should add to this essay to get it up to a really high A or to an A star. Tell me about today. Joe's not just showing what it's like for the Jewish population. He's given us a warning that this can happen again if we don't act. And it is happening again. In fact, it happens every single day in this world. That's what this book's about. Alors, on continue. So, the third paragraph here, he's talking about we see lots of things that illustrate life during the Second World War. We see kids crossing the line of the demarcation. We see like hunger, rationing. We see like the vitamin biscuits, the black market. True. What can you add to this? We don't just learn about life and like the kids have to take vitamin biscuits. Guys, we learn about l'ambiance en France. We learn about linked this to fear. We learn about denouncing and people lived in fear of each other. And the idea of fraternité is gone. Just like Pétain has changed the slogan from liberté, égalité, fraternité, and he's changed it to travail, famille, patrie. We see that here because the idea of fraternité has gone missing for some people, but it still exists in others. And you've got this idea of the old ideas of freedom, liberty, democracy, clashing with this new fascist France. Why doesn't this candidate mention that here? He's talking, and like, I don't want to slag him off because they've said it's a good mark, but he's talked about what we see. That's a bigger point for me. And there's some really good in-depth things you can do to add this. And then the fourth one, here we go. We see that each person represents a group of individuals. The family represents the Jews, Michel Marcellier, etc., etc., etc. Add good versus evil. This teaches us about people in the war, but people in general and human nature, that we've all got the ability to be good or evil. And therefore, the book goes beyond the war. We think about our lives. We think about the good and evil that's happening today, etc. And then finally, the one that they really liked was this point here, and I agree with him. It's definitely his best point. It's not, and this is what we've been trying to do all the way throughout, that they neglect. It's not just the book on the Second World War. Remember, the examiner said this is good when you started to challenge the question more. We'd have done it throughout, so we're getting a higher mark than this guy. So it shows the historical aspect. It shows things that go beyond the historical aspect. It's to dépasser, it's to go beyond it. For example, childhood and hope are very important. There we go. And you can say, guys, what about the message that good defeats evil, that you've got to help your fellow man, fraternité, all of this stuff can come in. That's his strongest paragraph. We can do it throughout the novel to make it strong. So hopefully looking at this has helped you and it's made you think about your essay that you're going to write for me, and it's going to be brilliant. Send it as soon as it's done so I've got time to mark it. Guys, I know this is a long lesson. I'm giving you like 2 hours to do this now. I'm making these doubles. Hopefully this has been really helpful piece of revision for you today and you've got a lot out of it. Bon effort pour moi aujourd'hui. Now think about this, reflect, and while it's fresh in your mind, get on this essay and make it class, guys. Right, guys, so that'll do for today. Merci pour tous. Alors donc, à la prochaine fois. Au revoir.